When you're looking for more and there's no place to go, it's a sequels only bonus show. It's not about sequels this time, you know, it's a sequels only bonus show. Doug and his pals, well, they know what to do. Talking about movies without a part two. Looking for more and there's no place to go, it's a sequels only bonus show. Talking to stars with Doug Ditsold, it's a sequels only bonus show. Sequels only bonus show.
Hey there, Doug here. This week's bonus interview is truly a special one for me. Growing up, huge fan of Whose Line Is It Anyway, and a huge fan of this week's guest, Brad Sherwood. Brad is just one of those guys that when you look at him before he even talks, he makes you laugh. And then when he does his impressions or his the songs that he can do right off the cuff, he makes you laugh even harder. And Brad's a great guy. We talked about, you know, growing up in Santa Fe, how he discovered acting, how he landed a role on one of the biggest TV shows. Spoiler alert, it's a drama. And he has some great stories from that. Then how he got Whose Line. And one thing when we talked, it was, and you'll hear about it throughout the conversation, it was probably about a month into the pandemic. So you'll hear us talking about that a little bit. But I'm actually happy that, you know, I took so long to put this out because him and Colin, they go on tour together. So they're starting to have some dates that are going to be opening up over the next few months, some that are actually pretty soon. So what I'll do is their website is colinandbradshow.com. I'll put the links in the episode notes. And then also what's pretty cool too is you can go on passportshows.com. I'll put the notes on there. They're actually doing virtual shows. They actually have some coming up. So the next few Saturdays, they have shows. So I'll put the links in that so you can check them out. Two hilarious guys, and you're going to love Brad. So I'm going to shut up. And here is Whose Line Is It Anyways? Brad Sherwood.
How you doing, man?
Good. How are you, Doug?
Pretty good. Pretty good. Thank you so much for asking. Thanks for taking the time.
Hey, no problem. I got nothing else to do.
That is true. So yeah. Thank you.
I don't know where you live, but I'm in a pandemic.
Me too. Yeah, I'm in Jersey, so.
Oh, yeah. Crap.
Yeah. Yeah. Not too good. But yeah, at least we can reminisce, talk about your career and how you started.
Sure.
Cool, man. So where'd you grow up?
Originally Chicago. Lived there till I was 10 and then moved to Santa Fe, New Mexico. Lived there through end of high school. Went to school for 4 years in Ohio. Then moved out to L.A. Lived there through most of my career. And then 5 years ago, I left L.A. and moved to Las Vegas.
Oh, look at that. So where along, what was the first time did you get like that inkling to either do improv or act? Which one came first?
I wanted to be an actor since I was 8. So I was doing theater and plays ever since I was a kid, all through grade school, all through high school, all through college. I went to school, acting school for in college, and then moved out to LA to be an actor. And, you know, I liked being funny. So that was a strong suit for me. And then I got into an improv workshop when I was out in LA and was like, wow, this is what I want to do for the rest of my life.
Where was it at? What school did you, where'd you take the class?
It was just an improv workshop. It was a group called Gopher Broke, you know, gopher spelled like the animal gopher.
Yeah.
And, you know, I worked with them and then we started performing. And then I got into a group called Theater Sports, which are all over the country. They're kind of like comedy sports. It's like team improv with judges scoring the scenes and stuff. And it's really funny. Gets the whole audience into it. And then I got into Second City out in Los Angeles.
Oh, nice.
And just kind of never stopped doing it. I was trying to do as many shows a week as I could in L.A., you know, because I just loved doing it. And then eventually Whose Line came along and went and auditioned for that and got on it.
Yeah. So all along those lines in the early part of your improv, you're still auditioning. So like what year was like the first time you took that class?
I think I took that class about a year and a half into, so maybe 88 I took that class. Yeah. And just never stopped doing improv from that day forward. Like it was my obsession.
love improv, love watching Who's Line growing up, and love like UCB and Improv for Humans, all that stuff. Just
Yeah, UCB just closed down. I don't know if you saw the article in Variety, but yeah, it was like sort of unceremonious closing and firing and laying off of all of their hardworking employees. That was pretty rough.
The one in New York, right?
I think all of them. I think the one in New York and the one in California.
Oh, shit. Because they had two in New York for a little bit, and then they had to close one down, and then, wow, yeah. So they had to shut them all down. Wow.
Yeah, I think it was sort of bitter with, you know, they didn't, like, offer severance or, you know, at least to give them some money to tide them over till it was like, nope. So I don't know what kind of resurgence they'll have after that with the people that helped, like, work for nothing for so many years.
Yeah. Oh, man, that's rough. So when I do like research before I talk to somebody, because I like to dive in, and one thing that was really cool was you were in LA Law. So like when you email me back and you're like, I wasn't in any sequels, but you're in a lot of different things over the years, like LA Law. So what about that?
That was really fun and cool. It was my first professional job as an actor in Los Angeles. I got on and I did 6 episodes, and you know, I was mostly a funny person. So I went in and I auditioned, and I was actually, the first audition I did was for a different part, was for like the young new lawyer on the show. But I mean, I was basically 6'4" and I looked like I was 12. So, you know, me in a suit looked like, you know, a kid's first day trying to sell cars. I guess they liked me in the audition enough to have me read for this other part, which was to play the nanny of Michael Tucker and Jill Eikenberry on the show. And so I had a 6 episode arc on the show, and it was so cool because I watched that show when I was in, you know, college and even in high school. So to end up on a show that I actually watched for all that time, and I even got the old back of a director's chair with my name on one side and LA Law on the other. So it was like, oh my God, this is the coolest thing ever. And it was pretty much the last dramatic acting I ever did because I just naturally gravitated towards funny stuff and kind of kept doing that my whole life, and did a lot of hosting stuff. Most, you know, a lot of shows, whether they went or not, I probably hosted, you know, 20 pilots for different types of reality driven shows and game shows over the years.
Wow. What were some of them?
God, there were so many. There was one called This Versus That, that a friend of mine, John Hotchkiss, produced. You can actually look it up online. I think he still has a live site that has, you know, clips and stuff from it. It's called This Versus That. It was me and Mark DiCarlo, who used to be the host of Studs and was a friend of mine. We did Second City together. And it was kind of like they were looking at different ways to do things. Like, what's the best way to get through traffic in LA? Is it to weave along the freeway and change lanes as much as possible to get ahead? Is it to just stay in one lane on for a distance, or is it to take the side street? So we had 3 camera crews in limos with each one of us hosts, and we left at the exact same point and had to get to a different distance in bumper to bumper rush hour traffic using those 3 different things. We had to each adhere to one of those rules to see who got there first. And strangely, I can't remember who it was that got there first, but it might have been the person who took the side streets. And then there was another one where they were trying to figure out what's the quickest way to load an airplane. And one theory was you have all of the C seats get on the plane in order from the back. So like everybody in the window seats go first onto the plane.
Yeah.
And then they get in, and then the middle row seats, and then then the aisle seats. And then they tried another where it was just all the people from the back. And then they tried another one where it was just random. And so it's a fun show because it poses interesting questions on what's the best way to do something.
No, that's pretty cool. And you can actually buy all the episodes. I just watched there's a little clip for the airplane boarding, and it's you getting, well, many use getting into a little, what is that? A little Fiat.
Oh yeah. That was probably a different thing. Not so much as the same as a plane, but had a whole airplane full of people get onto an airplane set that is used for shooting movies, but it's functional just like a regular plane.
That's pretty cool.
And it was a fun show to do because it was kind of it was sort of a different take on Mythbusters.
Yeah.
You know, because we weren't taking things and debunking them. We were posing the what is the best of 1, 2, 3, or 4 different ways to do something.
Yeah, the tagline's pretty funny. It says this versus that is an all new investigative series that's 30% Mythbusters, 30% Whose Line, 50% 60 Minutes, and 3% Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants. That's pretty funny.
Yeah, John Hotchkiss, who wrote and produced the whole thing, also used to work for Penn and Teller's Bullshit.
Oh, nice.
So, yes, he has a very fun, smart, snarky pedigree. And we actually worked on a couple shows together. There was another one that was sort of like a curiosity version of Antiques Roadshow, but we didn't appraise anything. We just found all these weird things and talked to experts about them. He's always trying to find me work. I really appreciate that. Although it's been a while. Once we come out of quarantine, I should probably give him a call and say, hey, it's been like 5 years since you haven't tried to create a show for me. What's going on?
And you know what's cool? So it's so funny that sometimes the videos you can find on YouTube, and I don't know if you ever wanted to look this up or ever check this out, somebody cut together all of your scenes from LA Law. So it's literally like 10 minutes of everything you're in.
Yes.
You watched that?
I saw it once. You know, it's a little cringeworthy for me, not because I was so adorable and young, but I just was not the greatest dramatic actor in the world. But that's okay. I still made good. I never considered myself a real good dramatic actor. You know, everything I was cast in, even in college, was the musical comedies and the comedies. So I wasn't thinking I was ever going to, you know, be looking into Meryl Streep's eyes. So no one was more surprised than me when I got on LA Law, believe me.
Hey, they saw something in you, and you're on there for a little while, so that's cool.
Yeah, and you know, it was my first gig, and I was like 22, maybe. So, you know, it was fun. I don't have to be so hypercritical on myself, but you know, when you look back at anything, it's like looking back at a home movie. Everybody's always embarrassed seeing themselves younger.
Yeah.
Unless they were like a quarterback on a football team that was winning the high school championship, then that video is pretty cool.
Yeah, then they're cool. So, So Whose Line wise, what was your step to like, how did that audition come about? Somebody like scout you or is it open call?
Actually, it was, I was working at Second City in LA. There was a theater down in Santa Monica that we all worked at. And I was in the touring company. And Ryan Stiles was in the main company. And so we were friends and I knew him and I was actually even his understudy in the main show. So if he was sick or had to go work somewhere, I would take his spot. So when the producers of Whose Line from the British show came to town, they were looking for new people for the British show. This was long before it was on the US. And he said, they're coming to town. You should go audition because you could probably get on. And so I did. And it was like, I don't know if you've ever seen the play Chorus Line, but it was that same kind of brutal, you know, I went into the audition with probably 30 other people, many of whom I knew from the improv world. So it was like me and my buddies and peers and all that, all in a room with the producers of Whose Line. And then they just started running us all through games. And every half hour or so, you know, they would thank part of the group for coming to the audition, and then they would go. And then then there was 10, and then there was 5. And then it was, we'll call you. And I was the only one that got called from that whole audition. And it was, you know, every season, every episode I've ever done, I've always felt like I'm still auditioning for the show.
Oh,
so, you know, you never feel like you've got your job for permanent. Even when I went to do the Whose Line that first time for the British version, they shot them in New York that year. That was the only time they did it. But we were just doing a run through and a guy who had come all the way from Australia to do the show wasn't quite funny enough for the producers in that audition, and they sent him home after flying to New York from Australia, and he thinks he's going to be on Whose Line, and nope, he didn't get on. So I was always aware from that moment forward that don't ever think you're on this show forever.
But that's the beauty of improv, because you're always, you know, everything's new. There's there's no rehearsal. It's just you being in the moment and reacting and working with the people that you know now. Obviously, the first time, it was probably that first time you're, you know, cutting, well, not Ryan, but maybe Colin. I don't know who else would have been on that first episode you did of the British version. But man, you know it. It's every time you feel like you have to bring it because, you know, maybe they'll send you home like the guy from Australia.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I always, even later on when I've been on this show for years, I never took it for granted. I always knew I have to be as funny as I can possibly be, or I might not be on the season the next season. So, yeah, it's you always have to sing for your supper.
So you said it was Second City in Chicago or was it L.A.?
No, Los Angeles. Yeah, for a short time. They had a theater out in Santa Monica. It's called the Mayfair Theater. It's a beautiful old movie theater that they turned into a cabaret theater for Second City. And a bunch of people from different Second Cities, generations from Chicago and from Toronto, sort of started the main show out there. And they kind of did a greatest hits of some of their stuff. And then after they'd been there for a while, they wrote some new shows. Like the Second City always do. So it was really, you know, it was really cool to be part of that. And I took workshops from lots of great teachers like Jeff Michalski, and we learned from Del Close. Nice. And got to work with great performers in my cast and on the main stage too. So Ryan was in that show and Richard Kind was in that show.
Oh my God, Richard. I interviewed Lance Kinsey, who was in Police Academy, and he did a movie a few years back, and Richard was in it, and he had some pretty amazing stories about just the kind of guy he is.
I know Lance too. He's a really great guy. Oh, also, a Second City guy.
And yeah, just, yeah.
The sweetest guy in the world. I haven't seen him in years, but every time I spent time with him, I was like, this guy is so cool. I want him to be my friend in real life.
No, he was cool. I was able to pick his brain about Police Academy, and he did a movie. He had a really small budget. It was about he was inspired by his daughter's softball league. So he was mm-hmm. smart because he had a small budget and he wanted to shoot it quick. And he shot it in 12 mm-hmm. days. He got a bunch of good improvisers. So he got Richard. There was a few other people that he reached out to that he knew pretty well. And he was able to do it that quick because he had people that could just riff on lines. And he said it was easy.
You just give an outline and that's all they need.
Yeah. So your first time you do it, and then how long until they invited you back? On whose line?
I think I went back the next 2 years, I think. Yeah. I think I did 3 seasons of the British version in a row, and then we moved to America when Ryan and Drew and the producers got ABC to give it a chance in the summer with 6 episodes. And they reluctantly said, all right, we'll give you 6 episodes in the summer. And then it ran for 8 years in primetime.
Yeah. It's amazing. I'm sure, have there been other attempts for improv on? I'm sure there has have to have been.
Yeah. There's a Wild and Out is an MTV show that Nick Cannon does. Yeah. And I think there've been others there was one that was on NBC. It was an hour weekly thing where they would have celebrities who would have to walk into an unknown set environment with a bunch of other improvisers and sort of improvise their way through whatever was going on. And I don't know, it wasn't Honey, I'm Home, but it was kind of that premise. They would walk in the door and say hello and then have to start into the scene. And you know, while the other improvisers were sort of prompting them into whatever the crisis was, but they didn't know what was happening, you know? So,
yeah, you're doing the 2 years and then, you know, and then along the ways, you talked about all the hosting jobs you have. I can only go, the only ones I know are the ones that are on your IMDb, and you hosted, you know, The Dating Game.
Yes, I did.
Oh man.
Hosted it for a year. And then Chuck Woolery took my job. How dare he?
Jesus.
Yeah, I'm convinced that they had me and Gary Kroger, who's a Saturday Night Live alum from the 80s, I believe, or early 90s, maybe. But we both co-hosted, not co-hosted, but he did the Newlywed Game and I did the Dating Game, so that we were back-to-back packaged. And the production company that did it, I think it was Columbia TriStar, they hired us to do it, and we were both really excited. And the very next year, it got picked up, and they gave my job to Chuck Woolery, and they gave his job to Bob Eubanks. So I'm very convinced that we were like just the test pilots to get the plane off the ground, and they had every intention of bringing back the old guard once they knew that the market was going to bear out that the show would go. Because it was just too weird that they like sent both of us packing and brought in two guys, one that used to do a dating show and one that used to actually host the Newlywed Game.
What is that like, hosting a dating show?
The Dating Game was kind of, you know, it, and it always has been. It's kind of a chance to be on TV for people. And back then it was, you know, what most game shows were out of work actors trying to get on. And out of work actors generally got a lot on the game shows too, because they're good, high energy people that aren't nervous. So they're usually able to think pretty fast on a TV show. So they make for great contestants when it's a kind of game show where you're not just picking them out of the audience randomly, when you have, you know, segment producers pre-choosing them. So most of the people that applied to be on the Dating Game were young, you know, 20 something actors. So they were all, you know, so it was me kind of setting up two actors that really had no interest in actually going out after the game was over. Just they want a ticket to somewhere. You know, they'd go there by themselves if they won. But for example, one of the on one of the shows, the Bachelorette, for the show choosing from the three guys was Cheryl Hines.
What?
Yes.
What, like one of the first episodes? Like early on in that?
Well, this was long before Curb Your Enthusiasm.
Wow.
This was probably 10 years before Curb Your Enthusiasm happened. She was, you know, she was in the Groundlings, I think. And, you know, she hadn't broken in yet on, obviously, on Curb Your Enthusiasm. So yeah. Just like everybody else, you know, I did Win, Lose, or Draw when I first moved out to L.A. You know, that was my first $2,500 I ever made in my life. That's in Hollywood. Great. Yeah.
Now, I remember Steve Martin was on the old Dating Game, I think, in like the, geez, must have been like the late 60s, early 70s.
Yeah.
So, yeah, now that makes sense.
A lot of people were on it. I think maybe Tom Selleck was, too, if I remember correctly.
That makes sense. That mustache could probably break some hearts back then. So,
yeah.
Somebody saw that and they're like, that guy could be a cop with a Hawaiian shirt and a Detroit Tigers hat.
Exactly.
So, when it comes to Who's Lying, so you've done, you know, I don't know, God, what, 80, 90, 100 episodes of that probably?
Yeah, probably like close to 90, I think.
Yeah. So is there, obviously, you're great at all the games. Is there a favorite that you have?
Well, I kind of like the singing just because it's the scariest for me. It's the, you know, it's the hardest stuff to do, because if you're spoofing a certain type of band or singer, you have to sound like them. You have to sing about whatever the topic is. You have to sing on key and make sensible lyrics that are talking about the topic. And on top of that, you have to make it rhyme. And you're following the band to stay on key and go wherever they're going with the music and adapting to that the whole time. So I like that challenge, because as a purist of improv, you want it to be kind of fun and scary and always pushing you into the unknown. And so a game like that, where you're spinning a lot of plates at the same time, makes it just that much harder. I use that analogy a lot, spinning plates, but that's such an old circus act, you know, variety show thing that doesn't even exist anymore, that it's kind of like saying dialing the phone or, you know, look in the phone book, use the yellow pages. People are like, what the hell are you talking about?
No, I know. No, that is true. I kind of say things like that too. And because I'm like one of the last generation, not the last generations, but of those things, like, you know, nowadays, kids can watch whatever they want. My wife's an English teacher in seventh grade, and they don't get references. Like, she can show clips of things, and if anything, even in a book they're reading, they reference something from 20 years ago. They don't know that because they don't choose to watch that. When you were growing up, me growing up, you know, everything, whatever was on TV is what you watched. There was no really choices.
Yeah, yeah. We all had, whatever your age, there was a commonality that
yes.
that Everybody watched L.A. Law, and everybody watched the Saturday Night Live. And now there are so many options with streaming, and there's whole programs and networks that you don't even know exist. That's someone else's fixation.
Yes, that's true.
Like, you know, there's decades of children's TV and animation stuff that I know nothing about, that whole generations have grown up with. And they're like, oh, my God, that's so My Little Pony. And I'm like, well, I've seen the toy, but I know nothing else about it. and video games that were, you know, past my time, you know, Street Fighter and all that. And people are walking on, score, you know, and I don't know any of those references. I can do great centipede jokes and Space Invaders, though.
Have you ever done stand-up at all?
A couple times in college, and it really wasn't for me. I've done my improv show. I used to do a two-man version, and now I also do a one-man version that I've done at comedy clubs. And so that's scary enough, doing improv in front of a drunk comedy club audience.
Yeah.
But stand-up never really appealed to me, because I guess I didn't really have a clear like voice or persona or angle that I wanted to do as a stand-up. So you either kind of have to go in as a smart guy acting stupid to tell your jokes, or you're just a smart guy saying that everything else is stupid. Those are kind of your options if you aren't like from the South, or you're not an ethnicity that can then poke fun at his whole family and the way his family does things,
yeah,
you know, and or his immigrant parents. It's like there's that whole angle that just a tall, skinny white guy like me does not really have. I either have to be really sarcastic and acerbic and say, notice that everything's stupid, or you have to, like I said, come up with kind of a persona that's a little dopey, and so that you're sort of making fun of yourself in the way you misperceive everything.
Yeah, I don't know if there's like, you know, a Santa Fe, you know, growing up in Santa Fe, I don't know if that would relate to the rest of the country, the hardships.
Yeah, because nobody knows really about Santa Fe other than, you know, Santa Fe style and Chipotle flavoring on their chicken patty.
That's great. So from Whose Line, so you talked about it just now, the two-man show, that was with Colin. How did you form that bond that you were like, you and me?
Well, it wasn't so much a bond formed. It was, we were both doing the live shows with Drew and the whole cast. We would go out every Super Bowl weekend to Vegas, and we'd perform for a weekend at the casino, one of the casinos there. And there were like 10 of us in the cast. So it'd be like, you know, most of the games are two, maybe three people. So you'd get up and do a game, and then you sit down for two or three games while the rest of the cast rotated and got to performing something. So in an evening that was like an hour and a half, hour, 45 minutes long, you might be in three, four games if you were lucky. So, you know, there's just a lot of sitting on the bench, you know? So, you know, it was almost like a football team. Like if the defense is on the field the whole time, the offense doesn't get to play. So I had been doing a two-man show in comedy clubs, and actually our wives were talking, and my wife was telling Colin's wife, Deb, that Brad's been doing this thing. Would Colin be interested in maybe doing this in theaters with Brad, a two-man show? And she said, I think so. And so we all went out and talked about it, and we said, let's try it. And we went to the promoters and people that were sending me out, and they booked us into a couple theaters. We did a two-week run in November back in, 2002, something like that. It went great, and we have never stopped doing it since. So until right now.
Until right now.
We've been canceling shows. You know, it's hard to get people into the theaters right now. There are no theaters that have less than 10 people. So, you know, because that's the biggest group that's allowed to amass right now. So it's really hard to travel across the country to do a performance for 8 people that are all sitting 6 feet apart, not wanting to laugh or cough on each other. It's just not a good time.
That would, yeah, because they try to laugh and then it might sound like a cough, and then
right, if they laugh too hard and start coughing, then half your audience leaves. Now you've got 4 people 6 feet apart. It's really, you know, it's hard to get a laugh going.
So with your what's the format of your one-man shows? How do you do that?
You know, it's still sort of game stuff, but I bring audience members up.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah, it's really fun. And it's totally interactive with the audience. and it's goofy. And I end the show sort of doing a big question and answer where I answer all their questions to different songs. So I have all these, you know, really funny, you know, recognizable radio hit, sort of the karaoke version instrumental. And then I sing their answer to them to the tune of whatever the song is. And it's always a very popular, goofy show ender. And I just keep going. And, you know, I tell them, it's called Smart Questions, Stupid Questions. So I said, you can ask me anything about anything, like from science or nature or the world and blah, 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 anything but politics or sports, because sports questions are just not interesting to answer in a comedy show. It's just stats and who's better than who. And politics is too divisive, and it just makes me too mad to think about politics.
Yeah.
So I don't. And so it's just goofy questions like, what's a good cream for a rash? Or like, how does entropy work? Or, you know, something about physics. So it's stupid questions, smart questions. So they can answer ask one from either category. And some nights it's like 10 smart questions and one stupid question. Then other nights it's like 12 stupid questions. You know, so, it's fun because the audience sort of sets the tone for where they want to go with it.
That's cool getting them involved. I think that's, you know, all of Whose Line is funny, but it's really cool when you see people that are so out of their element, either when you're singing to them or they're in there moving around, you know, Colin and Ryan on stage. It's so cool to see people because they're, you know, they're doing something that they, for the most part, have probably never done before.
And that, and it's I like having audience members up on stage. Some people prefer not to, but I love it because it's just that extra element of what the hell am I going to do with this? And I think the audience gets more excited too, because of that heightened sort of extra level of fear. Cause they're nervous for the person on stage as an audience member, and they're nervous for us that we may not be able to do with it is something, you know, it's kind of like it's kind of when you go see some act of the circus that you're like, there's no way the lady on the unicycle is going to be able to kick that teacup up onto the top of the stack on top of her head. It's the same nerves that audiences have watching us either try and start doing improv to song or with an audience member up on stage.
That is true. That's so cool, man. Is there so you like the singing because you said it's kind of like hard, but you enjoy doing it because it pushes you. Is there one that you did and you're like, oh my God, I can't believe I went there. Was there like a female artist or anyone else?
The producers usually don't throw like a female at it, okay. But I never did like impersonations or anything. So sometimes the producers would want to try a certain musical genre beforehand just to see if we were comfortable doing it. So they might play some, like if they wanted us to do a Rolling Stones, like they say, can you guys just improvise a Rolling Stones about toothpaste? So we would just give it a try. And if the producers that were sitting there were like, oh, okay, that would work really well as a genre, and we're happy with how you guys sound and it's funny, then they would change what kind of Stone song they were knocking off on the night of the show. And then obviously they'd be getting, you know, suggestions from the audience. But they just wanted to see if we could do it. Like that's how the whole B-52 thing happened. Like I had never, ever in my entire life, I had never tried to sing like Fred Schneider from the B-52s, but they pitched it to us in a, you know, when we were workshopping the games, and they said, Brad, can you do the B-52s? And I was like, okay, I'll give it a try. And so I can't remember if Laura was even the keyboard player back then. I think she was, yeah. And so we were doing something, and she started, you know, just a B-52 sounding thing, and they had given me a suggestion, and I just started singing how I thought he sounded, and they all just started busting up because I literally sounded exactly like him. So that's how every one of my impersonations kind of came along, is I just tried it, doing it right there on the spot, and had never done it before. Same with Bruce Springsteen. You know, it's just like a couple of them that I feel like I really nailed. They were all completely a one-off the first time I did it in front of the producers. It wasn't like, you know, people like from the Groundlings or that are on SNL, they have like a giant suitcase full of everybody that they do all these voices and impersonations and stuff. Cause that has to be sort of part of your weaponry. But I sort of discovered that on the fly. That's during awesome. The years of Whose Line. Yeah, so, it was kind of fun.
So when you were in LA, did you try out for the Groundlings or any other kind of group or?
No, I was so busy doing theater sports and Second City while I was there that I was doing like four or five shows a week on all these different groups. And we had a splinter group while I was still doing theater sports. We had a group that was some of the upper tier of theater sports that we formed a group called Wrought Irony. And we used to perform at a club in LA called the Laugh Factory. And we performed there every Sunday night for 8 years. So that was just like, I had a gig every Sunday night in LA for 8 years. And we did three shows a week at theater sports. And then when I was doing Second City, I was doing the touring company show there on the weekends and taking workshops and teaching improv for a little bit at theater sports too. So I was just busy doing it all over town. And then there was the Herald Nights that started happening down in Santa Monica with all the old Second City alum. So we had people coming and jamming, and it was me and Ryan, and when Colin was in town, and Jeff Garland, and
that's awesome.
Jeff Michalski, and even Robin Williams sat in with us one time, and just like generations of Second City people from so many different companies over the years.
Man, that's pretty special. That's cool. Yeah. That'd be cool to be like a fly on the wall there. Or if they had that on, if they filmed something like that, man, that'd be cool.
Yeah, it was such a great time. I wish they had filmed some of them because some were just sublime, you know, and we would do four a night. There would be whoever showed up, and usually there were about, 25 of us. So they'd sort of split us into, you know, four groups of six. And then each group would just start off the night asking for like one suggestion and they would do a Herald on it. I don't know if you know about Heralds, but they're kind of like a long form improv. Yeah. And, you know, some people had done lots of Heralds and some people had done hardly any, but just had the Second City background or, you know, all that. Ken Campbell. I don't know if you know who Ken Campbell is.
No.
Your voice sounds just like him. He was on a show called Herman's Head and he's done a lot of voice, and radio stuff. He does a lot of tags and teases for a radio station called, I think, The Mountain. I don't know if that's just a local thing, but if you hear him, he talks kind of like this, and it sounds very similar to your voice.
Oh, well, hopefully somebody listens to this, and they're like, hey, you know, we need somebody to fill in for The Mountain in a few years.
You should listen. You should look up Ken Hunts a Camel. He's probably got some YouTube voice clips on somewhere on the internet, and you can hear him. He and Ryan, because he's also a Second City guy, we did a Second City sketch show pilot that unfortunately didn't take off because just the way things are. And it was me, Ryan, Ken, a little guy named Steve Carell, and a friend of mine named Sherry Bilsing. And it was, you can actually, if you look up Brad Sherwood and Steve Carell on YouTube, there's a sketch called New Concept. Or the ad guys, I think it is. And you'll see the two of us looking like we're 12 years old. It's freaking awesome. Write that down.
The show is called The News?
No, I was on a show called The News. This was a pilot called, what was it?
Life As We Know It?
Life As We Know It, yes.
Oh, yeah, cool. Yeah, they have it listed on here because maybe there was just one that was out there for Comedy Central. Mm-hmm. They have it as a TV movie on your IMDb. Huh. Oh, look at that, man. That's awesome.
Yeah. So that's a cute. And then the guy who is the boss in that is Ken Campbell, but he's doing a character voice that doesn't sound exactly like his voice, but you can kind of get the gist of it.
Oh, man, I'll check that out after this. It's pretty cool.
But just to see me and Steve literally looking like we're 12 years old, it's hysterical.
Yeah, I watched the documentary. It was Too Funny to Fail, the Dana Carvey Show one. And the commercials that Steve Carell was in were so funny. Like he was in like these random like burger chain. I don't even know where, maybe they were in Chicago. Because I know that's where he was out of. And it was pretty funny.
And this was long before the Dana Carvey Taco Bell special. This was, I don't know how many years before, but I remember I was excited to see that he got on that afterward.
Wow, man. That's so cool. Looks really, I found it. So that's good. Cool, man. So Brad, one question I like to ask people, it sounds like obviously you've always wanted to, you know, do theater. You always wanted to be an actor. Was there anything else? Did you ever have anything else in your mind as like a fallback, or was it like this or nothing?
Well, I think everybody wants to be a rock star. Yeah. So, you know, there's that. I play sort of bad rhythm acoustic guitar. So I write songs, you know, I used to write a lot of them when girls would break up with me. So, you know, and when I was younger, I was sort of this weird dichotomy of musical styles. I loved like hard rock and metal. And then I also liked Cat Stevens and James Taylor and Jim Croce. So I had two sides to me, this soulful, introspective, soft folk. And then just like, oh, Metallica, Twisted Sister, Motley Crue, AC/DC, you name it, Judas Priest. I was into all of that. So,
do you ever perform live anywhere?
Musically? No, yeah. No. Maybe, well, I think I did a coffee shop once for a bunch of friends in LA once, but it was so weird because I just like, even songs I knew backwards and forwards, I like panicked and couldn't remember all the words because it's the only time I'm nervous, because I'm not nervous when I'm improvising and I have no idea what I'm going to do. I'm very comfortable at doing that. But I was just like, oh, so scared to do music on stage, especially because it was just me and the guitar.
I just thought like a really funny sketch you talked about. You used to write a lot of songs when, you know, somebody would break up with you. It's like they have a sketch. I don't know like where it would be, but yeah, this guy, he becomes very successful because a girl broke up with him. And then he finds a girl. He's still touring. He gets married, but his album sales are going down. So he like has to do something to get her to break up with him, because then he can have inspiration again.
Yeah, that's called Billy Joel.
It's Billy Joel.
Yeah, Billy Joel wrote the greatest albums, and then he married Christie Brinkley, and Uptown Girl came out. So, you go from Piano Man to Uptown Girl, you know things have gone wrong.
That's funny. I wonder if other artists like that, if you look at their like discography, and you're like, oh, I mean, this album sucked. It's like, oh, he just had a kid. He was really happy.
Music, the best music comes out of pain and rejection and unrequited love. A lot of the best art does, but really music is done by jilted lovers and guys who can't get the girl to pay attention to it. It's a very protracted, but it's like, you know, birds have their mating calls. We have rock and roll.
Thanks, Ian, for taking the time. It was a fun, you know, picking your brain and talking about how you got started and your one-time gig as a dramatic actor.
Yes. Yes.
That was cool.
Yeah, who knows? I might have to, maybe I'll do my own dramatic YouTube channel where I just read really dramatic pieces from screenplays and plays during this time when everybody needs a laugh. That's what I'm going to go. I'm going to go the other direction.
Yeah, dramatic head turns.
Yes.
Over and over, just like shortcuts of you just turning and looking at different things in your house.
Yes, just like little quick Snapchat videos of me doing dramatic takes.
Wasn't Brad awesome? He was such a blast to talk to. And I don't know if he did the dramatic Snapchat short videos, his dramatic readings that we talked about, but everything else that you heard throughout the interview, I'll make sure to put in the episode notes so you can check it out. The Life As We Know It with him, Ryan, Ken Hudson Campbell, which he said that I sounded like. I don't know. Maybe. I don't know what I sound like comparing to other people. But if you guys are listening and you're like, hey, Ken Hudson Campbell, you do sound like him, let us know. Again, our Twitter is @sequelsonly. And I want to mention again, their website is colinandbradshow.com. And then also check out their virtual shows, passportshows.com. I'll put all the links in there. And thanks again, Brad. And don't forget to review, rate, share our podcast. Follow us on all social media @sequelsonly. And don't forget to check out our website, sequelsonly.com. Good night.